Thanks to Storyblocks for sponsoring this video. Today we're talking about the A9 III, a camera that has easily been your most requested topic in the comments and on social over the last couple months. Now, I don't have a complete review for you today, but I do have some test results to share. I was waiting for Sony to send me a final production copy of the camera before I tested it too heavily, and that's what we have here. So let's get undone. What's happening, everybody? I'm Gerald Undone, and my focus breathing is called meditation. So as I alluded to in the intro, Sony lent me this camera to make this review. I don't get to keep it, no money changed hands, and Sony does not get any input on this video's production or get to preview it before it's posted. So the main thing I was interested in testing on this camera was the dynamic range. We already know the rolling shutter is non-existent because of the global shutter on the camera, but historically, making a change like that usually sacrifices dynamic range. But before we jump into that, I'd like to share that this is probably my favorite body from Sony when it comes to build and ergonomics. It's not that different than something like the A7 R5, but it's a culmination of everything good Sony has done so far. We've got the R5's flippy, spinny, twirly-whirly LCD screen, an excellent viewfinder, full-size HDMI, dedicated covers for mic and headphone, four independent dials, isolated controls for photo and video, the Alpha One's drive and focus combo dial, and an extra custom button on the front that I believe is new to the A9 III. The contour and slope of the shutter button has been improved, and there's a satisfying new clickiness to the top thumb dials. Truly the best body Sony has made, and I hope this design is carried forward to other models in the future. Internally, it has all the features we've seen from the last half dozen Sony cameras, plus a plethora of new stuff designed to leverage its incredible photography capabilities. But for video shooters, it maintains the new video priority display, the at-a-glance main pages in the menu, the log shooting mode with user LUTs, and so on. But it's also the first camera to borrow options from the vlogging line, like the dynamic active stabilization seen on the ZV-E1. It's also got the self-timer for video, the auto-framing, and the AI autofocus stuff. And it also has the new webcam protocol that allows up to 4K 30 over USB-C. I honestly couldn't find anything missing. If we've talked about it in the last few camera reviews, it's almost certainly in this camera too, and in some cases, a more refined version. But there's even a few new additions, like now you can set the shutter speed to increments that better line up with frame rate for 180-degree shutter, like 1/48th and 1/96th of a second. Still no shutter angle though. And inexplicably, still no 30p when shooting H.265. So we've got a new body with a 6K stacked global shutter sensor, all the bells and whistles Sony's developed across their different camera segments, their best autofocus, their best stabilization, and in my opinion, their best design and ergos to date. So how's the dynamic range? It's fine. So as usual, I busted out the Xyla 21 and I ran some dynamic range tests. So if you look at the top here, this is which test was run. So in this case, it's 4K 24 at ISO 2000. Now keep in mind, the base ISO on this camera is ISO 2000 when shooting S-Log3. Normally with S-Log3 on other Sony mirrorless cameras, it's around ISO 640 or 800. So this is significantly higher. So that's something to keep in mind. Now, if we look at slope base DR over here with a score of 14.7, that's basically how many stops we can detect total. So this would be, you know, a 14 plus or a 15 stop sensor. And then the numbers below that are based on noise tolerance. You know, how many stops if you're willing to accept X amount of noise. And normally we look at the 0.5 or medium score, which is a signal noise ratio of 2. And in that case, we get 11.5. Now this is definitely a little bit lower than what we would see on a normal, on another Sony mirrorless camera. Now, the only thing with the Sony mirrorless cameras is we don't really know what's going on in the processing pipeline. We don't have any control over noise reduction. There's generally no setting in the menu to be able to turn it off or turn it down. So if we just assume that noise reduction is the same on, say, something like an A7 IV versus the A9 III, then we would say that the medium score is about a stop worse on the A9 III because the Sony mirrorless cameras normally score around 12.5, sometimes a little bit more, and this is at least a stop worse than that. But I have a theory that maybe the noise reduction isn't the same on the two, or definitely the way that the noise is processed doesn't feel the same to me on the A9 III, and I'll show you some examples of that in a second. But first, let's jump through some other results here. This is 4K 24 at ISO 5000, and the reason why I did this test is because some people have suggested that they think that ISO 6400 is sort of a second native ISO. Now, I don't have any proof or official word on that, but I do notice, and you can see here if I flip back and forth between ISO 5000 and 6400, that there is sort of like a flicker and the noise does seem to clean up quite a bit. Now, I don't know if this is just a new level of processing that's implemented at ISO 6400 as we get into the high ISO, or if it actually is a dual native. But I did run a test, and at ISO 5000, you can see that we get a medium score of 10.2, but at ISO 6400, it jumps up to 10.7. So there definitely is an improvement. Could just be more noise reduction, or it could be some kind of dual native situation. But it's not, in either case, it's not a true dual native where we're getting back to our first native scores. We're not getting 11 and a half stops again. We're still worse off than we are at ISO 2000, but seemingly better than if you were at ISO 5000. So if you're using this camera for video and you're shooting at ISO 5000, you might be better off just bumping up a third of a stop to get to that 6400 and then, you know, compensating in another way. Regardless of what it's actually doing, it does appear to test a little bit cleaner. So that's good to know. And then 4K 120 at ISO 2000. I wanted to test this because this camera seemingly doesn't have any limitations on the 4K 120. I mean, there are still some quirks where you can't turn on, you know, dynamic active stabilization and so on, but it's not like it crops in or does anything extreme in 4K 120. The framing looks the same, the image looks the same. So I wanted to see, is the dynamic range the same? And yes, still getting at least 11 and a half stops, even in 4K 120. So that's great news. So here I have a clip of moving through the ISO ranges on the A9III and the A7IV. I compared it to the A7IV because they're both, well, the A7IV is 7K, but they're both like 6 to 7K oversampled sensors of the same sort of era. And I wanted to see, what does the noise look like? So on top, we have the A9III. It starts at ISO 2000, and I compared it starting at ISO 800, but then we're going to move up from ISO 800 to 1600 and then to 2000 on the A7IV to see if at what point does the noise match. And around 2000 here, I was like, okay, yeah, I guess they look kind of similar when they're both at 2000. So I guess that's good to know. But then as we're moving up through the range, I noticed that 6400 wasn't really any better on the A9III despite that possible dual native ISO thing. So that was kind of interesting. If anything, it might be slightly worse. And then at 12,800, I would say it's clearly worse on the A9III than the A7IV. And even more so at 25,600, there is a massive difference here. And then finally, only the A7IV can do 51,200, which isn't even an option on the A9III. So in low light, I would say the A7IV still clearly wins, which is supported by our Zally 21 test results. But if we take a look at another clip here, we have the A9III and the A7IV both at ISO 2000, but I boosted up the exposure in post so we could really look at the noise. Look at the right-hand side of the frame and the darkness there. And you'll notice that the A7IV's noise seems to be more smoothed out, a little bit mushier, a little bit possibly more processed, where the A9III's appears to be finer. This was the same lens, same focus, same aperture, same everything. So then I took a closer look at the original Zally 21 test results and zoomed in to see what was going on with the noise there. Now on the left, you can see A9III with no extra noise reduction. On the right, A7IV with no extra noise reduction. So if we zoom in equally on both, we can see the same thing. There's a bit more, it seems like a less processed image. The edges are more refined, but there is noise throughout them. There's a bit more color noise on the A9III, and you can see more noise, more sort of like snow in the shadows on the A9III, where that's all sort of smushed away on the A7IV. So what happens if we do noise reduction in post to make the image on the left look like the image on the right? I know we're getting a little bit wonky here in terms of we're making a lot of assumptions that because we don't know what the Sony does internally, right? But let's say we take something like this, which I would say I did this in DaVinci Resolve, and it looks closer. It looks closer than the previous image did as far as what our blacks look like, how we've kind of lost a little bit of that edge, and how the color noise is quite subdued. If we run this test on the left again, in Imatest to see the score for dynamic range, now that it more closely matches the A7IV, the medium score jumps up to 12.5 stops, a full stop more, and pretty much on par with what we would normally would get from an A7IV or another Sony mirrorless camera. Now, to you as a shooter, you know, this could mean a few things. This could mean, well, you know, give me the A7IV. We're obviously excluding price and we're excluding everything right now. We're just comparing images, which image, which workflow would you want if everything else was the same? Well, you might say, well, the A7IV image is creating that for me automatically, and I have to do less work, so give me that. But alternatively, you might say, well, in the instances where I want to only put on a little noise reduction, where I really want to dial it in, or I want this or that, then the A9III gives you more control. Usually I opt for more control. But in this case, more control is really just equalizing what the A7IV is doing internally. And again, the A7IV looks better at the much higher ISOs. And can go higher, can go to, you know, 51,200. So I would still definitely give it to the A7IV, but it's not something where I would immediately say the A9III is just worse. I would say that it's different. It's noisier, for sure. The image is noisier out of camera, but you can work it a little bit to make it match. where the A74 can't really be worked too much more with noise reduction because it's already being processed to sort of, you know, the limit, I would say. Finally, I also did a basic rundown test. I set the overheating threshold in the camera to high. I charged the battery to 100%, then started recording in 4K at 24 frames per second in my 23C or 73.4 Fahrenheit studio, and the camera recorded for 2 hours and 16 minutes before it shut down because of a dead battery. I didn't have any overheat warnings, but as we discussed before, this is highly dependent on your ambient temperature. So all I can vouch for is that you can get over 2 hours of record time on a single battery and that it likely won't overheat in a 23C or less climate control environment. So that's all I have to report today. Let me know in the comments what else you'd like me to test. And also let me know how you feel about the compromise of trading some extra noise for eliminating rolling shutter completely. Worth it or nah? Something I'm convinced is worth it, however, is the sponsor of today's video, Storyblocks. If you're not familiar, Storyblocks is a stock media platform that offers unlimited downloads of diverse and high-quality content for one predictable subscription cost. No more expensive paperclip pricing. Just pick a plan, pay that fee, and that's it. And you'll enjoy a library of over a million HD and 4K video files, images, and motion graphics templates. And speaking of those graphics, Storyblocks has expanded their library beyond just Premiere Pro and After Effects and now includes customizable DaVinci Resolve templates for motion graphics and animated sequences, an essential tool for creating professional-looking videos at scale. And it's always easy to find what you're looking for in Storyblocks because the platform is very intuitive and new content is commissioned frequently to ensure you'll have fresh assets to satisfy your project. So to get started with unlimited stock media downloads at one set price, head to storyblocks.com/undone or click the link in the description. All right, I'm done.